Palantir.
Hey, this is not a test. This is rock and roll. Time to rock it from the Delta to the DMZ. Is that me or does that sound like an Elvis Presley movie? Viva Da Nang. Oh, viva.
Welcome back to the channel, everyone. Hope you're all enjoying your weekend. I'm getting ready for Christmas, as you can see. I love this time of year, having a good time. Today, I wanted to talk a lot about the All-In Pod. So if you guys don't watch the All-In Pod, you have to watch it. These guys give away a tremendous amount of knowledge for free. But in this episode in particular, they literally made the case of why I'm interested in Palantir, right? And they also made the case for the incorporation of OpenAI into everything from search to education. And what's interesting here is that I really believe it's confirmation that my vision, when I originally looked at Palantir and got really excited about it, is that the models will become the commodity and that the data warehouse will be the application platform of choice for most companies and enterprises. It won't be this fragmented SaaS landscape. And so Chamath is going to break down and play a couple clips, two of them from Chamath and one from Freeberg. I'm going to break down exactly what they're hitting on, why it's reinforcing the things that built my original thesis around Palantir, my vision of where technology is going and where I'm positioning myself within the technology landscape to take advantage of that, both in my career and in my investment decisions. And I think it's a really important episode. I think it's really huge validation for the community as a whole. And to let you guys know that we're ahead of the curve, like what these guys are starting to figure out are things I figured out years ago. And I think in large part, a lot of the community has also figured out ahead of the curve of experts in the valley or expert investors who do this for a living within the tech sector. And I think that that is an amazing achievement of this community. It reminds me of Tesla, the Tesla community being so far ahead of the game in terms of the EV revolution. So I really think we've hit gold here, and I really think you're going to enjoy these clips. So get ready, people. We're going to break these down, and then we'll dive into some more Palantir news.
Partnered with who was at Google that built TPU. We've been building silicon for this space. So we've been kind of going from the ground up for the last 6 years. A couple things that I'll say. The first is that I think we're going to replace SaaS with what I call MaaS, which is models as a service. And so, you know, a lot of what software will be, particularly in the enterprise, will get replaced with a single use model that allows you to solve a function. So these chat examples are one, and you can name a bunch of SaaS companies that were purveyors of SaaS that'll get replaced by essentially GPT-3 or some other language model. And then there'll be a whole bunch of other things like that. If it's a, you know, expense management company, they'll have a model that'll allow them to actually do expense management or blah, 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 forecasting better. So I think SaaS will get replaced over time with these models incrementally.
All right. So there you have it, Chamath breaking it down, models as a service, which is what I originally stated, you know, that the models will become the commodity, which you need as a platform to operationalize those models and incorporate them into your business. 100%. He's on point. I believe that the industry is quickly solidifying, you know, like they're basically all of the key players in the tech industry are gathering around this position now. And it's obvious because the average company cannot make a GPT-3, right? The average company cannot make DeepMind. I said this before, you can count the number of PhDs on one finger in most of these organizations, if they have any at all. So like the fact of the matter is that the average organization can't do meaningful AI research. These are black holes you throw money into. You need to attract the best talent in the entire world to come work for you to build anything meaningful that moves the needle. But that has been done, right? So like the fact that GPT-3 exists, that GPT-4 is going to be way better than 3, this is something I know a little bit about. So like, I think that what people are starting to realize is that the AI has just gotten so good that it can actually do things of value. Now, the challenge is the last mile, because it can do things of value that are interesting and fun. Chamath talks about this in the podcast, where he's basically saying, yeah, it's cute, it's a nice toy, but it can't give you a precise answer, right, to a hard question. And that is true, because these algorithms are generative. Like what I've noticed in my research at work is that you can absolutely get the wrong answer all of the time. and we're developing methods by which you can train the model to get the right answer. So I'm going to play another clip where Chamath now gets into the real meat and potatoes of why this matters for Palantir and its companies, because how do you train this model to give it a precise answer to hard questions?
Real value is finding non-obvious sources of data that feed it. So it's all about training. So meaning you can break down machine learning and AI into two simple things. There's training, which is what you do asynchronously. And then there's inference, which is what you're doing in real time. So when you're typing something into ChatAPI or ChatGPT, that's an inference that's running and then you're generating an output. But the real key is, where do you find proprietary sources of data that you can learn on top of? That's the real arms race.
Where indeed do you find proprietary sources of data? Well, just so happens, the U.S. government has quite a lot of proprietary sources of data, as does every company out there in the globe that's focused on solving specific problems in which AI can be brought to bear. So if I was a forward-thinking company and that was ahead of the curve, what I would do is build a platform that lets those companies operationalize that data, operationalize these models, and bring them to bear against the entire corpus that the company already has without having to give it away to a third party. That would be a really smart business model. It just so happens there's a company that does this and that already saw this coming way before any of us did, right? And that's, I think, a large part due to the research Palantir was able to do with the U.S. government way before anyone else figured out the symbiotic relationship between AI and humans. This is a real thing. This is like, this relationship is something we're discovering right now, as even at my work. This is what I'm working on right now, is how do we get humans in the loop in these systems to interact with AI to produce a better outcome? And Palantir has been doing this for over a decade. So they had the foresight to bring a platform to bear against the problems that every company are going to face when they go to integrate AI into their operations. So Palantir had it right from the beginning. They knew that it's not about replacing humans, it's about augmenting them. They knew that you needed a platform to operationalize models, which would become the commodity. And they knew that you needed a way to operationalize your data, so to train those models and to be able to, so that that model can give you a precise answer to hard questions. 100% on point. They were clairvoyant on this. Like, and the fact that the rest of the world is now just starting to figure this out makes me so happy in a lot of ways, because it's confirmation of what I believed when I originally started looking at Palantir in the first place, and also the value I see it bringing to businesses right now today. A lot of companies, though, haven't realized that GPT-3 or maybe DeepMind are going to be huge commodities for their business. And they should start thinking in terms of, like, how do we get the best models possible and then do transfer learning through you know, Foundry to get them to be able to move at the speed of our data stream, answer questions for our operators, and what does that use case look like? So the next thing we're going to talk about is David Freeberg kind of speculating on, like, what are the use cases that are coming out of this? Well, it just so happens I'm working on one of them at work right now, and it's incredible. But let me play this clip and we'll break down a little bit more about what those use cases look like and how Palantir plays into all this.
Years ago, Google started a product called the One Box, where they could take structured data, like what is the weather in San Francisco today? Yeah. And that top of the search result page just presented that data because it knows with high certainty the question you're asking, and it knows with high certainty the answer it can give you.
Yeah, clipped it from somebody's website, right.
So if that starts to become everything, then that One Box interface, and it's not just Google's ability to access all this data and index it and serve it and store it, there could be a lot of competitors to the One Box and a lot of competitors ultimately to search. And ultimately, you know, Google's core product, their search engine, could be radically disrupted by an alternative set of systems that have more of a natural language chat interface.
Which is literally why Google bought DeepMind, and there were a collection of human-powered search engines, Mahalo included, ChaCha, Answers.com, who are trying to do the human-based version of this. It just didn't scale.
We don't want to get ahead of ourselves, because one of the things we don't know is how much is going on in DeepMind. They're not very open like OpenAI is. They talk about some of the advanced frontier stuff like AlphaFold and so on, and they've been public about that. But a lot of that is really to generate interest and hype in what's next. But my understanding is DeepMind's been applied to everything from
ad
optimization, but also the ranking on YouTube videos to get people more engagement on YouTube, et cetera, et cetera. So there's all these ways that DeepMind's been applied within Google services
that we don't
see. And certainly within search.
Yeah.
But the question is there an entirely new interface for search?
Yes.
That risks Google's core search business? And I think that there certainly will be a lot of money thrown at this. And if anyone has any interesting ideas, send me an email.
So, Freeberg, if you're listening, I don't have your email, but you can contact me through the channel. Yes. And I'm actually working on this at work right now. So if you're, if anyone who knows Freeberg is watching, please get him in touch with me, because 1,000% we are working right now on new user interfaces, new user experiences that pair AI and humans together, and they're very different than the traditional ones. And yes, that could risk Google's core business if Google wasn't just happened to be sitting on top of the best, most advanced AI in the world. Now, as good as GPT is, like, I've worked with it enough to know all of the flaws embedded in it. You can't trust the answers it gives you is the first one. So you don't know if the answer you got is actually correct. And there's this thing called temperature in GPT-3, which controls its generative capabilities. How creative can the model be? And that actually, like, you have to set that to zero if you want to get a high quality answer that you know the model didn't interpret something into it. And a good example of that is, like, I was doing a video a little while back where I was showing research into Palantir technologies and customers who may have regretted their purchase, and the model just made shit up. You know? So, like, it made up articles that didn't exist. It made up quotes that didn't exist. And it can do that, right? So, like, that, it's a generative algorithm. So, like, the challenge when you build these interfaces is, like, one, just like to Chamath's point earlier, how do you bring the model to bear on a corpus in which you know you'll get the right answer? But then how do you actually, like, even on the back end, get the right weights into the request to GPT-3 and then pick the right answers that come back or the best answers that come back? And then further, how are you engaging the person on the other side to validate the responses? And so there's a whole bunch of work that I'm doing right now at my job that revolve around these things. And yeah, absolutely, I believe we're leading the way. We have a unique partnership with OpenAI. I believe we're doing some of the best work right now on this problem. But yeah, absolutely. And I think that, you know, as Palantir investors, like, if you look at what they're saying here, like, it's literally making the case for why Foundry will be the big data OS of the future, right? Like, if all of these things that they're saying are true, and if there is a challenge to Google search coming, if there is, you know, this new way of operating that doesn't involve the traditional interface, well, who's best positioned to make that future reality? And here's the funny part. What if the next wave, like what they're talking about, this next wave of innovation in Silicon Valley, next investment wave, what if that actually takes place with Fortune 500 companies, right? Because if we look at it, the early adopters of Palantir are all these massive companies. What if they're the ones actually leading the way in this interaction because they have the actual tool set necessary to make it happen? That would flip things in, like, on its head, right? So, like, imagine a future in which the major innovation is taking place now in this Fortune 500 spaces where supposedly the innovator's dilemma exists. It would be really interesting to see how Foundry in this new wave and push with AI could actually enable a whole bunch of innovation taking place in these companies that traditionally are optimized for efficiency and optimized for sustainability. They're not optimized for innovation. So I think that that could actually be a really interesting future and maybe change the paradigm a little bit, in which case, no, actually disruptive innovation can take place in industry as well if they're given the right tools, because guess what? They have a lot of data, right? They have the funds and the means to make it happen. So it'd be really interesting to see what the partnership between Google and some of these companies that are using Foundry is and how that partnership evolves over time. So stay tuned on that. And next up, let's take a look at some of the news. All right, in other news, the Cleveland Clinic contract, 10-year deal, that was amazing. Really, really congratulations to everyone on that. Hopefully they can work some of that magic with the NHS, who seems to be caving to some activist pressure and breaking that deal apart. A little very bummed that the NHS is splitting probably the thing that is most important in Palantir, which is the data privacy and security, which is fully integrated end-to-end in Foundry. So I'm not sure why they're making that decision. It seems like a horrible decision. It seems like it'll make the system less secure, not more secure. So we'll see what ends up happening there. But congrats on the Cleveland Clinic deal. What up, guys? The Lockheed Martin partnership, that was huge. Congrats to the entire Apollo team. That's, I think, the biggest deal they've ever landed. So congratulations. One of the interesting things about Apollo that I keep pointing out to some people is that there's this push in the React community, which is responsible for 80% of all web apps that are built, to go back to container-based workloads with to support server-side rendering and server-side streaming, which is in response to Google's push for Core Web Vitals and performance that all sites have to meet in order to be ranked appropriately. So there's this tremendous new huge market segment emerging of container-based workloads that were traditionally single-page web applications hosted on content delivery networks. So there's a massive expanding market there, and I expect that market expansion to continue for Apollo. More and more things are going to need to be deployed out to the edge and on device into servers and cloud environments. So I see that market continuing to expand. So if anyone from the Apollo team is watching, I would sure love to demo deploying React applications using Apollo. It's pertinent to my work as well. We do this using our own service catalog, but we use Next.js and deploy container-based workloads for our React apps. So if anyone's watching, would love to demo that on my channel. Also, Apollo could be a key component of a platform like Vercel. If Palantir ever wanted to build a platform where React developers could deploy and manage their Next.js applications, that could be huge. I think that's a multi-billion dollar market opportunity when you look at the number of React apps worldwide, especially if it was integrated in such a way that you could build Foundry-enabled apps. So like best practice reference architectures for apps that need a Foundry backend, that could be huge as well. So I'd be really interested to see how Apollo could play in a multi-tenant SaaS platform for Palantir that could enable a lot of these React apps out there in the wild. So stay tuned to that. Really cool. The FTX scandal. I don't know what's going on there. What up, Christian? Crazy stuff. Let's see if Sam Bankman-Fried is behind bars soon. So that was relatively interesting, and I continue to follow that saga. Also, technical controls, passwordless authentication series part 2 is out. I'll leave a link in the description. You guys should check it out. Passwordless offflows are all the rage. I'm looking into it at work right now. Solving the world's password problem is a big deal, and I'm really interested to see what Palantir is doing on that front. And actually, one of the core things that I was thinking about building as a proof of concept was like a sort of SSO component for Foundry that would make it easier for people building React apps to authenticate with the Foundry system. So we'll see if I have some time to put that together, though I'm extremely busy at work. Additional proof of concepts that I'm working on is a series of projects incorporating open source data. I want to demo how I could build a platform for analyzing Google Analytics data on Foundry, along with a platform for doing Dora metrics. Dora metrics measure the performance of software development teams, and I would just release those as free open source Foundry templates if anyone wanted to integrate them into their Foundry stacks, they could. So stay tuned for that. I'm going to try to find some time to carve out to build those, although I'm extremely busy at work right now. But stay tuned, and everyone, Merry Christmas, and I hope you're all doing great, and I will see you next week.